the name of one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. I had a prepared sermon, had a slideshow, had all that kind of stuff. One of these weird things about being a preacher is sometimes you're told, the only way to explain it is by the Spirit, that what you've attempted to do is not what you're supposed to do. And I have been prompted that I am supposed to just speak directly and to talk very plainly this morning about this situation. Suffering is something that we're all worried about right now. Suffering is something that our entire society is concerned about, and much of it is worried about the physical suffering and what happens if we catch the coronavirus, or even for those of us who are not in the category of people who are vulnerable, it's worrying about those who are, that we know around us, that we don't want to catch and have complications. Paul talks a little bit today about suffering, and we have to be very careful in the Christian tradition, because Christians have misused suffering throughout the ages. Paul says, suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. Now note that Paul doesn't say, God sends suffering to us in order to test our character, or God sends suffering to us in order to bring us closer to Him. You will hear people say that kind of thing. I don't find that to be a compelling argument from Scripture. It's that suffering is, for some reason, part of who we are as human beings. It's part of kind of the fabric of our lives, the fabric of our humanity, the fabric of creation. And Paul is telling us what can be made out of it. What can we gain out of it? And in some ways, we already start to see some of that. We see things as small as people reaching out to each other in untold ways, and people concerned about what's going to happen for the homeless and for the people who don't have food service during this time. People, even small things such as the people who own the copyrights for music and stuff in church music, granting blanket permissions for any church that wants to stream. You see all sorts of stuff coming out of society that's really positive. You also see the negative sides of society. You see the hoarding of things that don't even make sense, like toilet paper or other things like that, or bottled water, things that should be ready, have been readily available in the places that have even been devastated by this plague. As Christians, we have to make that choice, that suffering has some sort of meaning to it. It's not something that's pushed upon us. It's something we can draw out of. It creates endurance, because God's love has been poured into our hearts. Because God's love has been poured into our hearts, we are given that gift of endurance and the ability to be the best people that we can possibly be, to be those people that in our baptismal vows we talk about respecting the dignity of every human being. And beloved, we will be tested over the next few weeks as to whether we honor that baptismal covenant. We will be tested as to whether we can continue to think of ourselves as a community, or whether we think of ourselves just as individuals or small units of our family. And we stand together or we fall divided. Gosh, that's my former state's motto. Either we face this together and we continue to see this as something that we all have to pull together, or we fare worse. In the gospel today, this is one of the very long gospel reading, but this is one of my favorite stories from the gospel, because it's about this woman from Samaria. Now, if you don't know much about the way that stuff works in geography, basically the Roman province of Palestine at the time was divided into Galilee in the north and Judah in the south, and these are two different parts of this one Roman province that are largely Jewish, and there's this little area in the middle called Samaria, and these are people that are very similar to Jews in many ways. They do the sacrifices in their own temple on a different place. That's why Jesus and she are going back and forth about where the holy place is. They follow kind of kosher laws. They have their own version of the first five books of the Bible that are different than the ones that Jews hold to. The Samaritans still exist as a very small enclave in Israel today. But back then, they had had much more territory. And so observant Jews, if you were going from the north country to the south, you either had to travel through it or you had to skirt around it. People who were like priests and holy people would often to go way out of the way to avoid going through Samaria because they were considered to be heretics. They were considered to be people that were unclean. They were people that you didn't want to interact with. And here Jesus is walking right through the middle of it. And this drives the disciples crazy. Drives them always crazy because Jesus is never paying attention to the people the disciples think he should be paying attention to. So the disciples are out trying to find some food. They go off for the Doritos. And Jesus approaches this well, and there is a woman who is drawing water at noon. Now, we don't necessarily find anything unusual about that. We don't necessarily find anything that is problematic about that. But at this time, women didn't go alone to the well to draw water. So, and they wouldn't go at high noon when the sun is highest. You'd go in the morning or in the evening at a time when it's cooler. She's alone because she is ostracized from the community. That's the implication of this text here. She's ostracized from the community. And why is that? Well, we kind of get a clue from her back and forth with Jesus. This thing of who's your husband? Well, you've had five husbands, and the one you're with right now is not your husband. I mean, this is innuendo that everybody is judging her for. And Jesus walks right into the middle and bursts that bubble, much to the chagrin of everybody around him. He bursts that bubble and he reaches in. Sure, he's washed his hands, I'm sure it's fine. He reaches in and he pulls her out of that bubble and he lets her know that she is not alone. And in this time that we're going through right now, that is really important, that all of you realize that we are not alone. Suffering produces endurance, but we are not alone in our suffering. None of us are. Even if we're in a room by ourselves, Jesus is still there to pull us out of our suffering and to bring us into wider community. And those of us who follow Jesus are here to bring people into wider community as well. That's what we do. That's why we usually gather here on Sunday mornings in order to worship, because the worship of the church is something we do together. It's not something we do apart. Jesus was always creating community. We continue to do that in his name, and we will continue to do this even as we face this difficult situation that we're in. So those are just a couple of things for you to think about this Sunday as we move into a time that's really unprecedented in our society. I would encourage you, follow all the directions from the CDC, from the Wisconsin Department of Health. Wash your hands constantly. Maintain social distancing. Avoid large gatherings. You know, do all of those things. And we're told that if we do that, that especially for the most vulnerable in our society, the people that are most vulnerable to this disease, no matter what the effects on more healthy, younger people will be, we can ameliorate or take down the effects of this on the most vulnerable. Jesus was always reaching out to the most vulnerable, and it's our job now to, as Christians, to be responsible and to make sure that we remove all of those vectors that would hurt those who are the most vulnerable within us. Amen.